Hello, this is Freethought Forum, a program by the Atheist Society of Knoxville and the Rationalists of East Tennessee. I'm Faithless Forrest.
And I'm Thomas Paine.
And we want you to know that if you don't believe in God, you're not alone. Right here in East Tennessee, you can find free-thinking atheists and agnostics. This is a show for them and for people committed to life rooted in science and unfettered by supernatural beliefs.
On today's show, we'll examine the question, what is evolution, and give some answers.
But before we begin, we want to tell you viewers about the sponsors of our show, the Atheist Society of Knoxville and the Rationalists of East Tennessee.
The Atheist Society of Knoxville frequently has a fun meetup at a bar or eatery. The next meetup is at Tuesdays at 5:30 p.m. at a new location.
And that location Barley's. Is incorrect. You got it. Barley's.
Barley's Tap Room in downtown Old City, Knoxville.
Yes.
For details, go to KnoxvilleAtheist.org. When you get up to the meetup, look for the silver-jacketed copy of The God's Illusion standing upright in the table. And as Matt Delahunty at Atheist Experience says, everyone is welcome to our happy hour for food, drink, and conversation. But if you plan to preach, proselytize, provoke, or punch, please don't.
The Rationalists of East Tennessee have several regular monthly meetings. See our website, rationalists, with an S, .org, for details. The first and third Sunday mornings of the month are usually presentations or lectures with lively roundtable discussion. The second Sunday, we hold the Skeptics Book Club. On the fourth Sunday, we're mixing it up sometimes with a potluck get-together at a member's home, which we call a reflections meeting. And every once in a while, we do an adopt-a-highway pickup.
Nice. Later in the show, we'll give you our websites to visit our additional details, including times and locations.
All right. Well, I didn't bring anything for in the news. Perhaps our roving reporter from Central Illinois might call in with something in the news. So I think we're going to have to jump right into it. And I think we must have a slide with the title that says, what is evolution? And I guess we're going to maybe give several answers to this. I'm a physicist by education, and you?
I'm trying to be a plant cellular biologist.
A plant cellular biologist. So biology is your specialty, and therefore evolution. And I thought that maybe we'd talk about the word evolution, because it's going to have multiple meanings. So if I say to you the word evolution, what's the definition that comes most immediately to mind or most natural to you?
So when I'm talking about evolution, I think of gradual change over time, specifically in a biological context, that produces diversity of living organisms, which a lot of people, for biologists, is evolutionary theory. But how our evolution itself has its own origins and uses. I think you know a little more about that than I do.
All righty. So the word evolution has its Latin or most probably Greek roots, and those roots, when translated, are something like this. It says an unrolling like a scroll, and when we say the word evolution, there's a part of it that sounds almost like revolution, and you know, a cylinder, which is like the shape of a scroll, revolves. But there's a kind of a cool aspect of this etymology, and that is that if you have a book written on scrolls that unroll, you can read the whole book and you never turn a page. There's a kind of a continuity to it where you just write one sentence after another. It's like one generation after another. So it's actually a beautifully chosen word, I think, mm-hmm. to evoke the idea of continuous change without even the turning of a page.
I never really looked at it like that. It is very beautiful.
What's interesting is I got that from a dictionary. It's my mother's dictionary that was like printed in 1943. And Yeah, and in that dictionary, how should we say it was written such that the acceptance of evolution as a scientific fact was not subject to discussion. I mean, it was fact. And in 1943, that was less than 20 years after the Scopes trial right here in Tennessee.
I believe it's Dayton.
Dayton, Tennessee. Yeah, the
Dover or Scopes.
Scopes versus
Is it Dover?
No, the Dover thing was up in Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Maybe it's just referred to as Scopes. We will be coming up on the 100-year anniversary of it in something like 6 years. I imagine they do reenactments there every year. And I've on a couple occasions thought about going. But if you've ever seen the classic photographs of Clarence Darrow and William Jennings Bryan, the two contesting lawyers, there's photographs of them sitting side by side. I think they're on a table. They're outside, and they're just, all damp with sweat because it was a hot summer day. It's in July.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a kind of what I think of as a terrible non-historical aspect to the reenactments they do. They now do it inside the courthouse, which is now air-conditioned. And it's just terrible.
So I do love modern air conditioning.
It has actually discouraged me from going. And of course, when you're inside now, they have confined seating and they sell tickets and they're kind of pricey. If they'd done it outdoors and it was free, I'm sure I'd have gone by now.
You did mention something that I thought was interesting, and I don't know if we'll talk about it now or later. I'll let you decide. But you said they didn't accept evolution as fact, but it is evolutionary theory. And so a lot of people don't think of it as fact because of that.
Yeah. And so when a scientist uses the word theory and fact, they have connotations that are different from casual, non-technical use of the word. So within the world of the biological scientists and naturalists, Darwin announced the idea and described the mechanism first jointly with a publication with Alfred Wallace, I think, and then followed up with the publication of his book on the Origin of Species. And it was so persuasive that within a decade, within the scientific community, the biological scientists, they said, yeah, this is really it.
He had some resistance.
Well, but not
it wasn't that easy.
But not by a significant number of biologists. The resistance happens in other circles. It's the kind of thing where non-specialists who haven't even bothered to understand what the ideas of evolution are and the evidence, get utterly wrong. So that's mm-hmm. that's a kind of thing that we want to talk about on the show. Can we bring the slide back with the definition of evolution? And I'll do number one, you can grab number two, and then we'll discuss it. So this is just an online definition I found. The process by which different kinds of living organisms are thought to have developed and diversified from earlier forms during the history of the Earth. Synonyms include Darwinism, natural selection, and, quote, his interest in evolution. Maybe that's a usage, even though it's in the category called synonyms.
Right, because natural selection is a part of evolution, but not exactly evolution. The second definition here is the gradual development of something, especially from a simple to a more complex form. The forms of written language undergo constant evolution. Synonyms, development, advancement, growth, rise, progress, expansion. And this quote here is the evolution of language.
All righty. And so
this thing called change that it mentions over time, that's one of the hardest concepts, I believe, to grasp about evolution, is that time for us is only, on average, let's say 80 to 90 years. But this time, it was a long, long time ago.
And in fact, that's another way to talk about, well, what is evolution? Evolution, as we just read it, is the answer to questions that humans naturally ask as a result of having studied the world around them. The ancient Greeks were aware of fossils. The ancient Greeks lived in a mountainous region. They knew of fossils, of seashells that were found on the tops of mountains. And they wrote about it, that they were puzzled by it and asked the question, how does this happen? And so evolution is an answer to part of that question.
Yeah. Not a great flood.
Well, there's another aspect to this question, and that is that these shells that are found formed or you know, embedded within stones in mountains, they often correspond, they don't correspond to any living creature.
They look very different from what we know as shells and creatures of the sea today.
So what we see are the apparent dead remains of creatures in an environment in which they could not live, the top of a mountain, mm-hmm. as well as they look alien. Mm-hmm. So why are they where they are, and why are they different from creatures living today? So those are two kinds of questions that evolution is an answer to. There's another kind of question, and that is, why do cats look like lions and look like tigers? And why do dogs look like wolves? And why are there lots of insects? They have many characteristics in common, and an insect would be an insect that has bilateral symmetry, six pairs of legs, and yet there's this huge variety. So why is that? And once again, evolution is an answer to that.
Mm-hmm. It's very powerful in that way, because not only can we use evolution to answer these questions, but we can now answer the question, what would these animals have to look like to become in these certain sizes and shapes? And so not only can it describe the world we look at today, but it also can describe the world we can't look at in the past.
At least
not completely.
That's a beautiful example, in that there are fossils found on all the continents on Earth, including Antarctica. Mm-hmm. And there are dinosaur fossils in Antarctica. Now, dinosaurs are something like reptiles. And, oh, look, we've got a call. Here, I'll do this first. Hello, caller. You've reached Freethought Forum TV. There's no call screener, so give us a name or a nickname.
It's Charles from Central Illinois.
Well, hello, Charles. Thank you
for
reporting in. and how are things in Central Illinois?
Warm and muggy.
Warm and muggy. I think that describes here in East Tennessee as well. So today we're discussing evolution. Did you have something on that or something else to report on?
Well, one of the things I was wanting to ask people about is how well is that police force that church has down in, I think, in Alabama working out? Has anybody heard anything about that?
I'll confess I have not.
A church police force?
In Alabama, there has been legislation to allow...
Oh, the Jeff Sessions?
To allow churches to create something like a police force.
Oh, that's not dangerous at all. That's sarcasm. In case that didn't convey that.
Shark.
Yeah. Bottom line is, I haven't heard of any disasters yet. But you know, you got to imagine the first time someone gets hurt by one of these quote police officers, and then tries to sue, because that's the thing that's happened, I think, is that the state of Alabama has given the church release from liability.
Isn't there like a country that also has police force that governs like religious
like
law?
Like moral police?
Yeah.
Oh, meaning like
that work out for
Iran,
them?
For instance?
Did that work out well?
Or Saudi Arabia? Yeah.
Well, Saudi Arabia has cut back on that significantly. but not completely.
There are certainly mixed signals that come out of all those places.
I hope we cut back on that immediately.
Yeah.
But if you really want a good demonstration of that, you go to North Korea.
Well, now, they don't have a religious theocracy. They've got a personality cult, which is a different kind of religion.
Since the president is now on the mist, living eternally,
yes,
on the mystical mountain of whatever its name is, watching down from Most High and giving his blessings to the regime,
uh-huh,
as much a religion as the ancient Egyptian Foas.
Yes. Now, when if we talk about how words are parsed into their roots, theocracy means rule by a theocratic entity. The crassy part means rule, and the theo means, you know, a supernatural thing.
Yeah.
But Christopher Hitchens, I think, coined a delightful term. Maybe he didn't coin it, but he used a delightful term to describe North Korea as a
necrocracy.
Yeah.
Where it's
it is ruled by the dead.
Yeah, it's also just sad.
Necrocracy.
A state religion.
Yeah. That, you know, a dead man is still president. There's a little bit of, let's call it, separation from reality in their thinking there.
Mm-hmm. It just shows you, again,
they want reality to match what they want it to match, and if you don't like it, we punish you for blasphemy.
Dogma, in any type of form, whether it is a person that you can see, like Kim, or a person that you imagine, like God, is harmful.
Moving on to the word evolution.
All right.
Okay. One of the unholy trinity, Aaron Law, has a video out on the evolution of Genesis.
Charles, for the benefit, there must be at least one viewer out there who does not know who Aaron Ra is.
Okay. Aaron Ra is a well-known...
non-believer.
Atheist. And in regards to many of the direct gods, anti-theist.
All right.
He does not, you know, he says he can demonstrate that these specific gods do not exist and never had exist, who has a degree in paleontology, uh-huh, and has an extensive understanding that goes with needing to understand paleontology, like the different forms of radiomagic dating, the different forms of dating through geological strata, and the different forms of dating such as the tree ring count, deuterium, or something like that. Where you can count
dating
back
trees,
by using different trees to go back a significant amount of time.
Sure. Let me amplify that a little bit. He's also one of the sometimes hosts at Atheist Experience, which is a TV show that inspired our show here. So, in a sense, he's one of our intellectual predecessors.
Yeah. It's a good channel, but one of his most impressive things is his systematic classification, and he's putting together this website where he walks you through all the steps of evolution from the most simple organism to humans. And I think right now he's on episode, 33, so he's getting close to us.
All right.
It's really interesting because it allows you to see what parts from other organisms that we carry with us today, which is interesting.
Not to mention his excellent series, The Fundamental Falsehoods of Creationism.
That one is fun, especially the petrified trees and how he explains the strata is really cool.
All right.
And then the Genesis one cracks me up every time. I really enjoy the one you mentioned earlier.
Alrighty, and I drug us off subject here. I asked you to amplify on Aaron Ra because I think that makes sense. Where were you going with this?
In his video, he points out how Christians' view of Genesis, the book of Genesis, has shifted significantly over a great amount of time, except for the extreme fundamentalists that optimist has said every word, and it is absolute 100% correct. Anybody else in the universe is at best mistaken, at worst blasphemous, evil scum who worship Satan.
Alrighty.
And,
yeah.
Prior to the geologist discovering the concept known as deep time, everybody sincerely, truly believed that the Genesis was the true one account, at least in the Western civilization. And it wasn't until the late 1700s and early 1800s that the geologists began to figure out that, hey, this isn't adding up. And so there was an accommodation to the physical evidence versus the written word, we're not exactly certain what a year is to God versus what a year is to us, or what a day is to God versus a day to us.
Let me interject here. There's a nice phrase about this that Robert Ingersoll wrote, and that is that once writing was developed, then the ideas of the ancients got preserved, and then the unfortunate thing would happen that new facts would be discovered that were at odds with what was written, and the response of the people with these written words is then to become creative and invent new definitions for old words. And thus, a once ignorant but honest religion now attempts to preserve itself by dishonest means.
Very true. And Genesis, though, does the best job. I think it's the first book, and it's the best book to look at because you have
arm wrestle you over it.
You have chapter one, and then immediately in chapter two, you have this giant contradiction of the order of how the world was created.
Right.
So right there, you're like, thank you. I don't need to read anymore.
We've got a slide up here, Charles, where we got some other definitions of evolution used by other scientists. And so we want the one that says the other definition, Nathan. To a cosmologist, evolution is the story of the Big Bang and the development of the universe around us from a hot, dense phase about 13.8 billion years ago. Why don't you grab the next one?
To geologists, evolution, but not evolutionary theory, is the story of the history of rocks and the development of planet Earth and its condensation of interstellar dust and gases about 4.5 to 5 billion years ago. Also, the story of the moving of tectonic plates, the seafloor spreading, mountains building up and rising out of the sea, erosion, and the distribution of fossils, and also the creating of fossils.
To a biologist, evolution is the story of the development of species and the patterns of similarities and differences of all living things explained as a result of common ancestry. And I say common ancestry because that was something Charles Darwin emphasized in his book, Origin of Species, repeatedly, not special creation. Special creation is sort of the stamp he put on the description in the Bible where the Bible says, Yahweh created, plants that brought forth seeds after their kind, implying everything reproduced of its kind and there was no change.
What I really like is that when you push a creationist on the term kind, you run into trouble because they often can't define it, and what definitions they do give counteract somebody else's creationist concept of kind.
Oh yeah, they get real squishy there.
Ken Ham science, kinds.
Yeah.
They love that word.
Yeah. There's another kind of definition, or that we might discuss the merits of. Linguists have evolution in their subject, as do anthropologists. So, languages evolve. We speak English, but our language stems from a merging of a Germanic language, Anglo-Saxon, with French that was brought over by William the Conqueror. And yet, we can't understand Germans, and we can't understand French people, at least not well. I mean, there'll be occasional words they say, and we're like, oh, that sounds kind of like a word I know, and it may have a meaning that's similar enough that you get some communication.
In fact, if you look at the evolutionary tree of life, and you look at the evolution of language over time, they look fairly similar.
They branch.
They branch off like a tree, and one language is different from the other, but they have enough similarities, and then the farther away they are on the tree, the less similarities they have.
What's more is that as you look for the common words, you may be finding something like the common language from which they stem.
Exactly.
And
one of the things that Aaron Rowe noted in his fundamental theories of creationism is that French, Spanish, Portuguese, Romania, and Italy are all direct descendants from Latin. But the problem is that after all this time, you can't put a person from Spain and a person from Romania together and have them fully understand each other. So
it's a distant relative rather than a really close relative.
Right, like, the way Portuguese and Spain are, because they're literally, the two nation states are like next to each other.
Exactly.
Yeah. In college I studied a little Russian, and Russian is quite different. Very few words were common, but there were some, and where they were, they often shared a Greek root in common. I'm sure there were some Latin roots, or else they were very modern words, like the words for the radio, you know, just the way I say it. You understand what I said.
And vodka.
Okay.
That might be an ancient word that we've just assimilated. Their word for automobile is, I think, machina or machina. And for the public transportation on rubber wheels, not the ones on steel tracks, is an autobus.
Interesting.
So we can hear that and say, oh, I can see how they would have chosen those combination of roots to coin a word.
To combine, to create, come up with a new word for a new object.
Yeah. But I have a kind of question here. I'll let you both maybe tackle it. So linguists have evolution happening in their subject. Anthropologists, the study of past human societies and the physical remains thereof, well, they're talking about evolution of societies and so on. But do chemists have evolution? Does how chemicals work evolve?
Our understanding of it has evolved significantly.
Yeah, but that's not to say that what's happening in the natural world is changing.
Well, if you want to talk about...
In science, that's called an invariant.
Chemistry can evolve if you want to talk about abiogenesis.
Ah, that's chemicals that are evolving. But
you're talking about the idea of chemistry, the rules, okay.
And so same thing for physics. Do the laws of physics have an origin? Do the laws of physics change with time?
I don't know.
And that's
I would guess no, but I really don't know.
And it's actually a profound question, because we have to ask ourselves, if they were changing, what would be the evidence that we could detect for it?
Well, we're already looking at one stage of that, the cosmic background radiation, microwave radiation.
Uh-huh.
Which is what cosmologists and astrophysicists deal with. And they're looking at further and further back in time and writing out mathematical statements describing what they see.
Okay, Charles, so, I want to make a distinction, though. The cosmic microwave background radiation is, in a sense, almost an image or a picture of the earlier universe and how the universe has evolved. But we interpret it under the assumption that the laws of physics have not changed, and thus we can interpret it with the way we do. If the laws of physics changed in between, our interpretation would be wrong.
Correct. Yeah, so what they're looking for is discrepancies in our mathematical statements And
very
what
good.
We see in the cosmic microwave background photo or diagram or what have you. And one of the things they haven't been able to do is to go back to the point of where the different stages of different forces, electro weak, electro strong, and the rest of them were combined into one
unified force.
Unified field.
Yeah.
And so all they've got now are conjectures and ideas that might be accurate, but then again might not, and they say so.
That is an important point. Scientists make a big deal about identifying where they're uncertain, where they know that the theories break down. That's very honest, as opposed to what theists do, which is to try to explain away the discrepancies. So earlier, co-host here, Thomas Paine, I love saying that name, talked about how there's a story of creation in Genesis 1 and a story of creation in Genesis 2. In Genesis 1, the plants are created on the third day. And if people want to say, oh, well, that wasn't really a day, it was really a long period of time. So then, okay, the plants were created on the third really long period of time. Well, then on the fourth day, the sun and the moon and the stars were created. And so at this point, you kind of got to laugh and say, really, the plants were created a really long time before the sun. How is that going to work for
you? Not to mention, day was created before there was light. A star.
Yeah, well,
and the sun.
No, there was, quote, sun. Light, unquote, but there just wasn't any sources for it.
Yeah, yeah. And the word, well, in Genesis, use the words morning. You know, to us, morning implies this apparent motion of the sun across the sky due to the Earth's rotation. You know, what else could morning mean? And yet, there was no sun to rise until the fourth day. So that would be the first morning then, even though it's the fourth morning. So 1 = 4.
Right.
Okay, I'll let you go.
All right, thanks for calling,
Charles. See you, Charles.
All righty. So I guess the point I was going to make, and I first heard this expressed about, you know, the laws of physics, or that physics doesn't have the same problem that biologists have or geologists have, the problem of how did it get to be that way? There is no evidence that it was ever anything different. Now, that's not to say that the contents of the universe weren't different and distributed differently, but there's nothing that looks like evidence of saying, oh, and then at this point, conservation of energy started.
Right.
And that before that, there was no conservation of energy. Now, there'll be people who talk about, oh, well, the Big Bang is a creation event. And now we have to then stop and say, wait a minute, what do we mean when we say creation, made out of nothing? And I would say, well, what is the evidence that there was nothing before? And what you realize is that that's mere conjecture.
Yeah. There could be always nothing, and nothing could be fairly stable, giving the time of something that we cannot grasp. Or nothing could be in itself unstable and give rise to something.
Well, so far more importantly is that there's no way you can give me a piece of that nothing for me to examine its properties.
Right.
It is beyond any reach that we can conceive of currently. If we can conceive of a way to do it, and if we're lucky and it's within the realm of realistic physical experiment, then we might make progress on that. Mm-hmm. But when we talk about the Big Bang, we really should always say this was a hot, dense phase before which we're not sure what happened.
Right.
It may have been a creation event, meaning there was nothing, or there may have been previous universes, or there may be multiple universes. There's these ideas called brain theory that higher dimensional, let's call them collisions, produce an effect that looks to us like a hot, dense, early universe.
Then there's multiverse, which is the coolest one because it's very sci-fi-y, and I like sci-fi, and that universes are popping up and dying and growing, and we wouldn't even know because it's outside of our universe.
Yeah. So, but we're talking about evolution here, and I guess we should probably drag it back
to
the biological world, because that's what we want to try and...
Especially because cosmetology is not my forte.
All right. So, if I was a new student in a biology class, what would you want me to know about evolution? How might you begin the conversation?
I guess I would start with some of the things that we have in common with the things around us. I said we can see evolution through our design, our physical design. And we could start there because that's easier to grasp and see.
All right.
For instance, if you look at a bird's wing and you look at a human hand, we have the same bone structure underneath. Except it's just organized a little bit differently. So evolution...
Organized, the proportions of the pieces are
proportions
different.
And maybe one is fused together, but the same overall plan's there. So it's more like a Lego set, and then you have to tinker with the Lego set to get different shapes, but the Lego set pieces are the same.
There's a marvelous book that we did once for the... Rationalist of East Tennessee Skeptics Book of the Month. It was called Your Inner Fish. I think it's Neil, I'm going to say Steuben? I may be mangling his name. But he had a lovely way to describe limbs for pteropods, creatures that walk on the land. And these limbs have the characteristic of one bone, two bones, lots of little bones, and then digits.
Mm-hmm.
And that description covers the limbs of amphibians, the limbs of
fowl,
most reptiles,
birds.
Dinosaurs,
mm-hmm.
the birds, mammals. It actually even covers some limbs in a fish, that they have that structure. Lobe fin fish, I think, have that structure. And it is evidence of the common ancestry we have with creatures. And what's cool about it is that by looking at the fossil record, they could see that something like, I think the number was like 380 million years ago, there were no terrestrial creatures. And then 370 million years ago, there were. So right around 375, I may be off 10 million years here. Somehow I'm thinking I should be saying 385 million years ago was probably when creatures emerged on the land. And armed with that knowledge, they then said, let's look at geology maps, and where can we find surface rocks that are of that age, right in the middle of that time period, that are of a environment that is like a shoreline, because that's where creatures would be experimenting with somewhat terrestrial life.
Maybe they live on the edge of the water and they can come on land a little bit. They have two choices. Maybe one's better suited to protect from predators.
Or if you experience dry seasons, you want to hop from one pond to another,
yes.
That kind of thing. And they identified places like that somewhere like up above the Arctic Circle I was about to say it was in Alaska, but maybe it was over in northern Canada somewhere, as well as a place in Pennsylvania, and actually not too far from their university. So they actually found some pretty rough fossils in Pennsylvania, but then they went up to the Arctic where they found beautiful fossils, and the result is a creature that has a lovely name. It's an Inuit name, and it's called Tiktaalik, or maybe Tiktaalik. And it's a creature that's got a broad, flat head, looks a lot like an alligator to us, but then it's got limbs in the front that have one bone, two bones, a bunch of little bones, and unlike us, we have five digits, it has eight digits. But its shape is definitely adapted to support weight, so that it would come up, it could come up on the land and navigate around on the land. And this is a brilliant example of how evolution, the theory, allows us to make predictions about what we will find in the world, and it's true.
Mm-hmm. And this the reason why it's prediction, because we'd assume that the first organism on land wouldn't necessarily have to have full working legs like we're used to seeing, but maybe a mixture between a fish and what we now know as limbs for terrestrial animals. And so since the Tiktaalik had this long fan, now eight fingers, not a full fan, but a long enough fan, enough to have a flipper-like purpose where you can move around the water, but also, like Forrest said, be sturdy enough to support some of its weight outside of the water.
Yeah. So I'm looking at the clock here. We've got about 20 minutes left. We should probably do our mid-program break,
okay,
which is in there. And while we do this, if you have questions about evolution or other things that you might like to talk to an atheist about, give us a call on the phone number on the screen.
Oh, actually, there's a call now.
There's a call now.
Hello, caller.
Can we get a name or a nickname?
Hello, Forrest. This is Min.
Hello, Min. All right, calling from California.
I don't get a hi.
Hello, Thomas. Sorry.
Hello.
Yeah, so I have a question for you, Forrest, so, and you too, Thomas. So based on your understanding of evolution, so how do you counter the argument from people who support, you know, the so-called social Darwinism?
Yeah, so that's a really good question, because that's often thrown around a lot, Darwinism, or Darwinism as an atheist of God, or Darwinism as eugenics and stuff like that. But really, evolution is just a theory of how we have diversity. And so evolution itself is just a scientific theory. How people interpolate what that means to be as important is another matter. Obviously, humans are more complex creatures. We're all related. And in fact, one of the reasons, maybe this will answer your question, one of the reasons why I find evolution fascinating is that all of us are around like 99% similar. We're really closely related. And so I feel more connected to you and my human strangers more than anyone else. And so that would give me less of motivation to cause harm to any of my fellow family members. People that use evolution as a eugenics-like approach are social Darwinism. They take one little element from a theory, scientific theory, and they use it for nefarious things, in my opinion.
I'm going to answer it as well, Min. Evolution, as used by biologists or the other scientists, describes what has happened. There is no value judgment placed on that. It's indisputable that the Earth has changed. It is indisputable that the shapes and forms of life has changed. This theory explains how that has happened. It does not offer us the least bit of information to ask, how should we interact with one another? It doesn't give us justification to say, oh, the strong may exterminate the weak. That is not a conclusion that can be reached from the understanding of how things got here by evolution.
Right. In fact, not actually, evolution is the stronger of the fittest. It's not really stronger of the fittest. It's just enough to be able to reproduce before you die. And so it's not even really about strength.
Yes.
Which is a misconception.
Darwin doesn't use the phrase strongest of the fit or the strongest survivor or anything like that. What he would say is that the organisms that leave descendants are the ones that are most able to adapt. And that being unable to adapt to environments which are ever changing is the thing that causes an organism to go extinct. It's not strength, it's adaptability. Now,
not be able to mate.
Adapt or find sufficient food when the climate changes or something like that, which results in you not being able to mate. I think Min, have we answered your question here?
Well, I mean, like, the thing is, I mean, what your answer makes sense to me. And the problem, I think, is that when I look at how natural selection works, I mean, it's worked pretty gruesome way, because, like, pretty much, like, animals have to eat each other in order to, for the process.
Yes.
You know, for the stronger gene to progress, right?
Mm-hmm.
When I look at harmless species such as plants, they over time they develop toxin or anti-nutrient, and we humans have to, you know, make every possible way to neutralize them in order to eat them. So I mean, like, I think, you know, social Darwinism supporters do not make sense, but I think I don't know how to counteract the argument, because the way they say it, I mean, like, isn't that they have a framework for that? I mean, for evolution to work, it's pretty, the environment is not nice and neutral, right? It's pretty.
Mm-hmm. You could look at it this way. You could tell them, like, if they think the strongest survives, then that means anytime they're sick, don't take medicine, because apparently your genes aren't strong enough. If you need glasses, don't wear glasses. Apparently your genes aren't strong enough. That's silly, because we all depend on fighting against evolution. With modern medicine, with better living conditions, with hygiene, with vaccines, all these things. And so I think the people that you talk to, not only is it a gross ideology that they have, but they don't understand the concept of evolutionary theory. It doesn't have any type of ideology on its own. It doesn't have feelings. It doesn't care what succeeds. It's just a mechanism of how life came to be, or change over time, I should say.
Min, in Darwin's book, Origin of Species, he addresses this issue somewhat. What he says, he doesn't address the issue of, you know, morality of it, so to speak, but he states the obvious, which is that in nature there is tremendous, I think the word he used was degradation of the young. The young of most creatures do not make it to adulthood. Now, in the case of plants, they often produce massive amounts of seeds. I've had a maple tree in my yard, and, you know, in the spring they drop those seeds that's got a little heavy end and then like a little wing on it. So they come down like a helicopter.
Or like a dandelion.
Yeah. So each plant has to make a huge number of potential baby offsprings, and for them to just hold their own, one of those survives. And if they're sexually reproducing, you know, they and a mate have to together produce two. Now, that's undeniable. That's the way it is. That's actually part of why evolution happens, that there are more young born than can possibly make it to adulthood. They're competing for scarce resources of food and places to live. And so inevitably, if there's any variation within the population, if that variation makes some individuals less able to compete for food or more able to compete for food, they will leave less or more offspring, and the genes that made those differences will perish or flourish accordingly. Do you follow?
Yeah.
All right.
If you look at it that way, revolution is really just about love. Passing babies.
It's about genes getting into the next generation. And, of course, genes don't have intention. Genes are merely encoding for the proteins and other components of life that, when they're in the neighborhood of the cell that's composed with genes other genes of their parents. If they work well together, then they may leave more offspring. So genes don't compete on their own. They compete with the help of their siblings, so to speak. And if they're successful, they move to future generations. Min, if you have anything quick, we'll entertain it, but then we need to let you go, and we do need to finish our mid-program break since there's only 9 minutes left.
No, I'm good. Thank you so much for taking my call. I'll call back another
time. Alrighty.
Bye, oh, man.
Quick, though, how's the weather there in California?
Right now, it's pretty sunny and pretty warm.
All right. I'll confess, I haven't heard about fires lately. The big fires are largely contained now?
I haven't heard any news about fires so far recently, so pretty.
All right. Well, thank you for being our West Coast reporter, and have a good day.
Thank you. Thank you, you too. Thank you. Bye, Thomas.
Thank you. All righty. So, mid-program break. In case you're just tuning in, this is Free Thought Forum, a program by the Atheist Society of Knoxville and the Rationalists of East Tennessee. Free Thought Forum is funded jointly by them and by individual contributions.
We have moved. This is our new regular time. Every Wednesday from 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. Eastern on Knoxville Community Access Television, channel 6, 12, 99, or 193, depending on your local cable network. Tell your out-of-town friends to see us streaming online at ctvknox.org.
Today's show is live. It is October 3rd, 2018, and you can call the number on the screen while we ask you to watch these informative videos about our sponsors. Hit it, Nathan.
If you live in or around the Knoxville area and are questioning your religious beliefs or simply believe in one less God than everyone else, well, you're not alone. The Atheist Society of Knoxville is a fun and friendly group of people just like you that meets twice a week at a bar or restaurant. We meet every Tuesday night following the show. You'll find our group either inside or on the patio. Look for Richard Dawkins' silver-jacketed book, The God Delusion, standing upright on the table. But if you plan to preach, proselytize, provoke, or punch, please don't. We all question what we believe at one point in our lives. If this is the time for you, come join us for food, drink, conversation, and fun. Do you find stories of talking snakes laughable? Do you prefer the scientific method over supernatural beliefs? Are you concerned about religious leaders and organizations imposing their values and rules on your body, your family, and the rest of our society? Well, take comfort in the fact that you're not alone. The Rationalists of East Tennessee meets for fellowship and provides a forum for people who support skeptical thinking and rational discussion of these and other issues. To find out more information or to find out about our next meeting, visit us on the web at www.rationalist.org.
I'll do it.
Okay.
And we're back. The Atheist Society of Knoxville, or ASK, meets one or more times a week. We have evening meetings for food, drink, and conversation. Find us online at KnoxvilleAtheist.org. The purpose of the ASK is to supply a venue for community camaraderie, outreach to atheists, agnostics, freethinkers, and other like-minded persons in the East Tennessee area. Our next meeting is next Tuesday, 5:30 p.m., and as of a few weeks ago, we're back at Barley's Tap Room and Pizzeria in Knoxville's Old City. We had a great time last night.
Yes, we did. From the Rationalists of East Tennessee website, upcoming events are this Sunday, the first Sunday in a long time, shows host Joe Barnhart, Larry Rhodes, and Faithless Forest will speak to members about this, how our history, how we go about producing episodes of this show.
All right. The RIT Skeptics Book Club meets the second Sunday of the month. The October book is unknown because we haven't updated our website. Our bad. But I've alerted people, and hopefully that'll get up there right away. That was a book from some months ago. The time is 2 to 4 p.m., and the location is Books a Million, 8513 Kingston Pike, Knoxville, Tennessee. It's the one near the... Well, I think it's Walker Springs exit. You need not have read the book to attend, but of course it helps.
The third Sunday is Religion for Atheists. Elaine, how do you say that name? Elaine Day Botton speaks about religion and discusses his book Religion for Atheists in a YouTube video presentation. We meet in a cafe. We meet in a cafeteria annex on the Goins Administration Building. Use the back entrance to avoid having to pass through the church crowd.
See rationalists.org for program and meeting times and locations and the list of future books once we get them up there. All righty, we've got about 4 minutes left. You had some things you wanted to talk about, I think would be characterized as unintelligent design that evolution has produced.
Yeah, if I was going to design something, I probably wouldn't design it this way. And this is how we can make fun of and also enjoy how unintelligent our design is. And if you're a guy, you probably know this one. Testicles are a bad design. Why? Why do you think they're a bad design for us?
They're a little on the vulnerable side.
They're very vulnerable. They're vulnerable, and they like to attach to one leg or the other, and it's very uncomfortable at times.
And yet this is apparently something that has to happen.
No, it doesn't have to happen.
For at least mammalian testicles, all of our testicles developed internally, and either shortly before birth or after birth, they descend into a cooler environment. If they stay internal, they can't produce gametes.
Right. Sperm dies, basically.
Or just don't develop to begin with.
Correct.
So this design has got this unfortunate consequence on it that they're now not protected. I mean, if you actually look at how our bodies work, our bodies have, you know, a living stone around most of our organs to protect them against, you know, falls or teeth of predators. And yet the most important tissues for reproduction in males is outside the living stone protection.
Outside in a non-regulated heat source. Which is interesting. Do you think something that needs to be protected and need to be obtained at a certain heat would be inside a body that maintains a certain heat? However, it's outside because it needs to be cooler.
All righty. We got about half a minute, and then we'll have to begin.
What animals don't have their testicles out?
I think reptiles don't. I've heard
reptiles.
Birds don't.
Birds don't. They actually have a hotter body temperature than us. And then whales. Yeah. Whales don't either. Hippos, or rhinos.
Internal, huh?
Yes, they're all internal.
So
protected from any loose kicks on the soccer field or a mean person.
Apparently, Yahweh fixed that then for them, but not us.
Yeah. He loves rhinos and whales a little more than us.
All righty. Well, we're getting low on time here, and we've got this marvelous quote from Charles Darwin. If you're game here,
sure. So, there is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers, having been originally breathed into in a few forms or into one, and that, while this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from a simple beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved.
So, I think he nails it there. People sometimes will say that, oh, well, you know, scientists, you go explaining things and that robs the mystery. I think that only robs ignorance, and that understanding always makes things more beautiful.
I agree. Like, for instance, evolution, one of the things I mentioned earlier is that how we're all closely related, and that gives us, I guess, motivation to be better to one another.
So you and I are both humans. We could conceivably have children that might mate with one another in the future. We can, even though we're both males, we could share genes through our possible ancestors.
Mm-hmm.
We have relatives in all the other animals and plants and microorganisms as well. But it is time to start wrapping things up. We're going to have to race through this. Get out your pen and paper. This has been Freethought Forum, a program by the Atheist Society of Knoxville and the Rationalists of East Tennessee.
You can give us feedback by emailing us at freethoughtforum@yahoo.com and our Facebook page, Freethought Forum Knoxville.
You and your friends can see this show on Wednesday evenings from 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. Eastern on this Knoxville station or online at ctvknox.org.
In addition to call any guests, would you like to thank you from Sam, Rye, Faithless, from technical support and staff at CTV Knox, and all the viewers and callers. Thank you, Min and Charles.
Nuns, those who identify with no religion, are the fastest growing religious group in the United States. If you don't believe in God,
you're not alone. We'll be right back.